How do we measure the innocence of a child's life? Would we measure it by value, by usefulness, or by fragility? Or is it the case that innocence is inherent and cannot be measured? Maybe there is no gradation, no gray area, no middle ground. Perhaps innocence either exists or it does not. Every day that we are allowed to enjoy the freedoms and pleasure this country has to offer, a growing number of children are having their innocence ripped away.
Under the federal law, anyone who recruits, patronizes, solicits a minor under the age of 18 for the purposes of a commercial sex act can be found guilty of trafficking. Upwards of 80% of all confirmed sex trafficking cases involve U.S. citizens, and up to 40% of those cases involve the sale of children.
Unfortunately, to some of our fellow countrymen, destroying the human spirit in a child is a worthy sacrifice for a lucrative and flourishing business. However, this goes well beyond the sickening perversion of the flesh. There exists an occultic evil that has been awakened. These demonically fueled agents of sexual abomination regard the bright light of innocence as a trivial and inconvenient flame that must be snuffed out. We must not close our eyes from the sting of the smoke any longer. It is time we look upon the smoldering ashes of what used to be our children, become properly horrified, and finally decide to adopt within ourselves an insatiable motivation to expel this scourge from our land. It's time to stop ignoring the desperate cries of our children.
It's time for another episode of The Sean Tabbitt Show, a podcast where I connect you with thought leaders from across the globe, dig into some of my favorite topics like personal development, marketing, spirituality, and pretty much any other shiny object that happens to catch my attention. Today, my special guest is my friend Josh Peck, and we're going to be discussing his new documentary film, Silent Cry, The Darker Side of Trafficking. Josh, it is truly an honor, sir. Welcome to the show.
No, thank you so much for having me on. The honor's all mine, and it's really good to talk to you again.
Well, it's funny, you know, I was thinking about this. You and I, have, over the years, we bumped into each other at conferences. We know a lot of the same people, but this is the first time you and I are doing a formal interview together, so I'm so glad we're finally able to make this happen. And you know, I've read a couple of your books, you know, I've been watching your content for years, but I know inevitably there's somebody watching this, listening to this, who's going, I have absolutely no idea who this Josh Peck guy is. So let's have you kick this off by sharing a bit of the Josh Peck origin story. For those meeting you for the first time today, tell us about your superpowers, your special abilities, whatever it is. What do we need to know about you?
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, being on your show is really exciting for me because I remember when I was first starting out in full-time ministry, I think you were doing book reviews and things back at that time. But I remember seeing your stuff online and thinking, I want to get a book of mine reviewed by him someday or be on a show or something. Like at the time, it kind of seemed like this just kind of, you know, you've made it. You know, it's like a prestigious kind of, you know, you've made it if you've reached this level. So here I am 6 years now in full-time ministry and I have made it. So
you've arrived, my friend.
I have arrived.
I can't promise it isn't all going to be downhill from here, but enjoy the time on the mountain while it lasts.
I fully expect it to be, because how can you top it? But yeah, so it's really fun for me because I remember thinking that. But yeah, so my name's Josh Peck. I've been in ministry for full-time ministry for about 5 or 6 years. And when I had first started out, I was just self-publishing books that I was writing. And I came out of I was born into the Baptist church, and I don't know that I would consider myself necessarily a Baptist today. I mean, I'm not opposed to Baptists at all, but I'm just kind of more non-denominational, I guess. But at the time, the specific church environment that I was brought up in, they didn't answer a lot of questions that I had. And I think it's just because they didn't know. And, you know, fair enough. There's a lot of things I don't know, too. But at the time, I took that really personally. And I was bothered by it. And I ended up quitting church altogether. I didn't go to church. I never denied Jesus, but I didn't go to church. I ended up getting into New Age and tried to like marry Christianity into New Age because I was afraid of hell. So I didn't want to deny Jesus and I didn't want to go to hell, but I also wanted to, you know, explore these questions that I had, like about aliens and ghosts. And, you know, I had questions. I didn't know that those are answered in the Bible pretty, you know, explicitly too, but I didn't know that. The church that I grew up in focused mainly on New Testament, sort of like, you know, how to live your life kind of stuff. And it wasn't as much into like the real meat of theology, especially with Old Testament stuff. They kind of ignored that. So those answers that I was seeking were in the Bible that I was rejecting at the time. So I got really heavily entrenched in New Age. And to make a very long, long, long story short, God got a hold of me and pulled me out of that deception. And I gave my life over to Christ for really the first honest time, like where I really knew what I was doing. It wasn't just something I was born into anymore. It was, no, I'm going to actively seek you, Lord, whatever that means, wherever you take me. I don't want anything to do with this false spirituality anymore. I want the real thing. And then after that, you know, moment of commitment, I asked God to lead me. And it was shortly after that, those questions that I had started getting answered. You know, I would start watching like Bible programs randomly online, and they would bring up things that I had questions about. And I got so inspired by that. I thought, you know, I can't be the only one. There must be a lot of other Christians who find themselves in this situation where they have questions that aren't being answered by the church. So it really made me want to be in ministry towards the end of answering those questions, providing, you know, books and resources and materials to people who had questions like I did. So I just started writing. I started self-publishing and learned a lot through making a lot of mistakes, you know, along the way. But a lot of times that's the best way to learn, and made some friends in ministry and the areas of ministry that I was seeking towards as well. And they helped me out a lot. I had Dr. Michael Lake gave a couple of my self-published books to Tom Horn, who, if you're not familiar with Tom Horn, he runs Skywatch TV and Defender Publishing. And at the time I was looking for a publisher, but you know, I didn't want to go with anybody. Because I didn't know much about publishing, and it would have been very easy for somebody to take advantage of me, of my ignorance back then. And I didn't want that to happen. So, I was real careful about it. But Tom had just started Skywatch TV. They were filming their very first episodes ever. And he took such a chance on me because he didn't know me at all. Like I said, Dr. Michael Lake, he suggested that Tom have me out and meet me. So Tom flew paid to have us drive, me and Christina and my wife, drive out. We met the whole team, recorded a couple of episodes of Skywatch, and it went on my self-published books. It went really well. We did kind of like a pseudo publishing sort of deal at first to basically he just wanted to help distribute my self-published books while I kept all the rights and everything. So, and he said, you know, this way you can get to know me, I can get to know you, we can see how we, you know, work together. And it was just a hit. I mean, we really hit it off. He became a really close friend of mine really fast. About a year after those first episodes, maybe a little less, but it was a pretty short amount of time. Tom emailed Christina and I and offered us jobs at Skywatch. We lived in Michigan at the time, Southeast Michigan. And so he invited us to come and move to Missouri and uproot our entire lives, which was actually easy for us to do because we didn't have anything really tying us to Michigan. Not really super close with family. So there wasn't a whole lot there. And we had hit it off so well with everybody at Skywatch that first time around. We just knew it was a God thing. So we packed up, moved, and I've been at Skywatch ever since. Published books through Tom. I don't self-publish anymore. And now I am doing documentary filmmaking, and it looks like that's going to be the thing that I'm going to focus on for the future.
Well, and one of the things I'll say I've appreciated about your journey, Josh, is you have been bold to live out wrestling with your faith and ideas and going after things that are sometimes out on the fringe of what the church wants to talk about. And what surprised me, I think, is I've immersed myself more in the world that Skywatch and other ministries are a part of, is that there are thousands and thousands of people who have the exact same questions you were wrestling with, where they, you know, they go, I go talk to my pastor And he looks at me like I'm crazy. And you're like, dude, they didn't cover this in seminary. Go worry about something important. And while, you know, certainly some of these things aren't salvation issues, they might be secondary issues. But for the person who is just psychologically struggling or wrestling with this, it's like a be-all, end-all thing for them. And they need to finish processing through it. So I appreciate the way you've processed so many things publicly and so many different resources and talks I've seen you give. Like, you give a place for people who feel like they don't have anybody else to go to say, hey, I'm worried about this thing, or I discovered this in the scriptures and oh my gosh, I don't know what to do with this. And so hats off to you for being risky and taking on the hard challenges. Cause I know a lot of leaders and a lot of pastors don't want to touch any of the stuff you guys talk about with a 10-foot pole because they just don't know what to do with it. Cause it's like the 80-20 rule. There's 20% of the people are worried about it and they want to focus on the other 80%, but yet that 20%, so to speak, they need somebody to speak to their issues too. And so I don't know if you want to give any more commentary about that, but I know that that's something that people just really appreciate about your ministry.
Well, thank you. That means a lot. And that's what I really strive for because, you know, I don't, something else that can kind of happen in this kind of world, you know, where people have questions is there are other people, and I wouldn't consider them Christian ministry because this isn't ministry, but there are other people that will abuse them. They'll take advantage of their questions. They'll put out super sensationalistic stuff that's not grounded in scripture at all, but they will give it the label of Christianity. That kind of thing is actually what kind of led me into New Age to begin with. From Christianity to New Age and then, you know, finally coming out of it. But there are people out there who will spiritually abuse these people because they can make money off of them. And I was one of those who was being taken advantage of when I was in New Age. And I had people telling me, yeah, this is Christian. This is totally compatible with the Bible. And, you know, and it's not all their fault. It was my fault too for even entertaining it. But at the same time, that does happen. So while I do want to do anything that I can to provide answers where I'm able to, I also, you know, more than anything else, I ask for prayer to keep me humble because I don't want to go off on a limb and then try to provide an answer to something I don't know or I don't have the answer to. I'd rather just say I don't know. And I find more often I do just say I don't know because some people have some really interesting questions, which is great. But I don't ever want to use that to my advantage in ministry in any way and say, hey, you know, maybe I could get a few more clicks if I, you know, say things this way or, you know, I just that stuff is so abhorrent and it's killing the church in America and it's ruining Christianity. So I try to stay away from that. So while I do try to provide answers while I can, more often than not, that tends to lead me to say, I don't know, because there's a lot of things I don't know.
Well, and I tend to roll in a couple of different circles that are outside of the traditional evangelical space. My main job, I work in charismatic publishing, so I'm going to lots of places that make others nervous. I've gone to I Hear the Watchman and some other conferences, which for lack of, and I don't mean any like anything negative, but just kind of the fringe church space where we talk about things that you're probably not going to hear about on a Sunday morning. And I will say, I've been to the Hear the Watchman conference a couple of times, and what impressed me most, what humbled me the most, was seeing hundreds of people come to the Lord and go get baptized in the swimming pool and just to listen to people and hear their stories and hear them say how they didn't feel like they had any place to belong. And, you know, to see, you know, I feel like a lot of people throw a lot of hate and anger towards things that they've never gone to experience. And so to go to an event like that a couple of times and see the tangible ministry, people that were meeting the Lord for the first time, people that felt like they had somebody who would listen to their story and help them to process. It was just a beautiful thing. And so, you know, I'm not going to lie. I went to, I think my first Hear the Watchman conference, and I'm like, I have no idea what I'm walking into. And yet what I saw just really, really blessed me. So
that's and isn't it great? Isn't it great too that those speakers, a lot of them don't agree on like non-salvational issues. There's a lot of them that have different ideas about how prophecy might play out, things that typically people online will fight about. But speakers that hear the Watchmen and a lot of other, you know, places right. like that, they don't fight. We just all love each other. And I, some of the best conversations I've ever had with people are with people who disagree with me on something. You know, I love those kinds of conversations because like I'm a pre-trib dispensationalist kind of guy. So, you know, there's a lot to disagree with, especially it seems like in fringe Christian circles, because a lot are like pre-wrath and even some partial preterists and stuff. And I like having conversations with those people who are, you know, respectful and loving and realize, you know, this isn't a salvational thing. This is like two brothers can disagree. Let's look at the scripture and let's worship Jesus together and let's reason together and see what we can come up with. I think that's so exciting. And so much of the church is missing out on those amazing relationships and building that trust with somebody that you disagree with. They're missing out because a lot of churches today, unfortunately, they'll just shut down anybody that has even a question about something that could turn into an answer about some other different way of thinking, or, you know, a lot of that's shut down, and it's really unfortunate. So I agree with you. I love Hear the Watchmen. I love those kinds of ministries, and that's what I strive to do myself.
Yeah. My last comment on that is, you know, we're in an age where healthy dialogue and disagreement is undervalued. And in fact, if you don't have the exact same opinion, all of a sudden it's hate, or it's just, you know, I think for millennials, it's really hard to think that people might just, at the end of the day, just completely agree to disagree. Yet it's that disagreement and the discussion that help us to really be sharpened and to process and to really press in. And, you know, without that dialogue, we can't actually really strive to understand each other. So disagreement, right. Processing, it's a good thing. Jump in, kids, and see what happens. You might learn something and be stretched in the process. Maybe read a book from that guy you disagree with, and you never know. Maybe you'll see that he or she is not as crazy as you originally thought. But enough Amen. About that. We have to keep moving because we have a documentary film to talk about. You know, Josh, we've already alluded to that you're really accomplished, you might say, on the media mountain. You're a TV host, you're a podcaster, you're a multi-book author. But documentary filmmaking, as you said, it's a brand new space. So I guess two things. What drew you into going into the documentary film space? And then what was the catalyst to move you down kind of this dark rabbit hole, you might say, in the exploration of what's behind the child trafficking that just is running rampant right now?
Yeah, it's interesting because I look back at my life and I think, you know, how many times do I have to learn this lesson before I'll just finally get it? But when I first started getting into ministry, I didn't want to write. Like, you know, when I went through my history just a minute ago, I kind of breezed over this, but I'll talk a little bit about it now because it kind of correlates with the filmmaking thing. But I didn't like writing. I kind of ran away from writing my whole life because when I was in kindergarten, I loved it. You know, I would write dumb little stories about dinosaurs and E.T. and, you know, stuff like that. E.T. was my favorite movie growing up. And I remember I had this, she was a Christian, but I went to public school, a Christian school teacher. I didn't know she was a Christian at the time. I found that out years later. But she told me, and I don't remember much from when I was that young, but I remember this, and this is going to sound like it like isn't a big deal because every teacher tells every kid this, but for me it was different. She saw one of the books. I had actually like constructed a book and wrote some book about dinosaurs or something. And she looked right at me and she says, "You're going to be an author one day." And it wasn't like typically what you would think of, "Hey, you're going to be a great writer someday. You know, that's adorable. You know, keep doing that. That's great." It wasn't that. She just like said it matter of factly, almost. I do believe in prophecy and things, but I'm not like a charismatic. So I'm not going to say that she spoke a word over me or anything, but it sort of was like that. So in middle school and high school, I lost my passion for writing. I started to really hate it. And again, public school, I was writing about things that I didn't enjoy or even that I didn't agree with. Like there was a whole bunch of stuff in world history that I had to write about that was kind of anti-Christian. And I just started to really hate writing altogether. And so on top of that, I was also really into like guitar and being in rock bands and stuff. So I was like focused on music, and writing is like the complete opposite of that. So I didn't want anything to do with it. But I kept feeling this pull, like I'm going to have to write someday. I'm just going to have to get over it and do it. I couldn't explain it. It was like something in the spirit. So after I got out of, and there's a lot more I could say about that, but just to kind of wrap up that part of it, after getting out of New Age and getting back into Christianity, it was finally like this submission thing where I was like, all right, Lord, I will write, you know, when I first, I didn't know how to do it. Didn't know how to write a book. I didn't know anything about outlining. I didn't outline my first book at all, 'cause I didn't know what it is. I just sat down and wrote, which is like not how you're supposed to write a book apparently. But that's what I did. And that was the last time I ever did that. That book took a really long time to write because of that. But, I was scared of it though. I was really scared because it was something new. I didn't think I was going to be any good at it. There's other people who are doing it. That's a lot better. Also, writing books is really hard to break into. And I was, 'cause I have a rare bone disease. I was of disability at the point. Job, and this was like the worst choice for me to make. You know, if all I'm thinking of is how am I going to make money, this is the worst thing for me to do. So, but I just stepped out in faith and did it anyway, and it turned out okay. But so that worked out, and you know, I found a publisher, everything worked out great. Well, then filmmaking kind of came up a couple of years ago. There was actually a position at Skywatch. Tom has been wanting to really, really like expand a film department at Skywatch. And, you know, we've been through some different ideas and different things. And I've always kind of had the opportunity to just step up and really go for it and say, you know what, I'll do it. I don't know how to do it yet, but I have some basic editing skills because I've been editing all the Skywatch TV episodes since I started there up until a few months ago. They have somebody else doing that now, but so I had some basic editing skills. I knew a little bit about how cameras worked. And I had opportunity where I could have stepped up and said, you know, I'm going to do it. But I had that same fear. I was too scared. Like it was something brand new, you know, ISO and aperture and what are all these camera terms? And it freaked me out. So I was open to it, but I didn't really like pursue it as hard as I could have. And, so after a couple of years, the opportunity came up again. And then for some reason, this time was different. And I think it was because I was thinking of the writing thing. You know, I didn't want to do writing either. And it was not for anything godly. It was just fear and cowardice. And then when I finally did step out in faith and do it, it turned out okay. So I thought, you know, this is probably one of those. So I just stepped out in faith and said, all right, you know, give me a chance. I really want to do this. Give me a chance to do the film department thing, you know, before you make any decisions, if you're going to keep it open or close it down or whatever you're going to do, let me have a shot. And Tom is just awesome. And he wants to support his, you know, his people that work for him, and he's just great. So he gave me the opportunity and he said, look, you can even take work time to learn filmmaking, you know, take online courses or look up YouTube videos, whatever you want to do. But let's try it out. Let's see if you can make a movie. And if it's good, then we'll pursue it. And if not, we'll figure something else out. You know, maybe we'll go back to books or something. But so he actually gave me a shot and I took it really seriously. And went out of my way to learn as much as I could. I mean, it was just YouTube videos. I can't afford film classes. So I looked up like lighting and film. I looked it up on YouTube videos. But nowadays you can learn pretty much anything, you know, unless you're wanting to do open heart surgery or something. You could probably learn that too on YouTube these days. So it took about a year from beginning to end for Silent Cry. When it first started, we all had a big meeting at Skywatch to kind of decide what the first movie was going to be. And we really landed on the child sex trafficking thing. There were other ideas, but we thought, you know, out of this list, this is the thing that can help people the most. You know, this is the thing that can really save lives. You know, a movie about aliens or Nephilim might be interesting, but is it going to save anybody's lives? Is it really going to help? Is that more important than children being trafficked? So we landed on that, and I was that topic alone scared me, you know, just the topic, because it's so horrifying and it's dark and I have kids and I didn't want to think about this stuff. But I just really felt God saying, you need to do this, Josh. Like you just have to, you know, it's either you do this or you're being disobedient at this point. So, I just stepped out in faith and did it. And, the end result is Silent Cry. It took a little less than a year from the moment that I decided I'm going to try making a film to, the release date, which was just, I don't know, a couple of weeks ago. So in that whole time period was about 10 or 11 months, something like that. But it is out now. And I hope we did the job that we set out to do. What I really wanted to do is I didn't want to sugarcoat it, but I didn't want to sensationalize it either. I didn't want to make it. I didn't want to get into some of the really conspiratorial areas that could be true, but are really difficult to prove, really difficult to show evidence for. But I also didn't want to sanitize the whole thing and only make it pure statistics and take all of the heart and emotion out of it either. I didn't want to sugarcoat it and make it sound like it's not as big of a problem as what it is. I just wanted to handle the topic truthfully because that's how I try to write my books. And that was really kind of the only thing I had to draw from in terms of experience. So yeah, it was probably a long answer, but that's kind of how we arrived to where we are today.
Well, and I just want to acknowledge something you said a little bit ago that, you know, it was scary to step out and do the filmmaking thing kind of in the way it was when you had to be stepping out as a first-time author. And, you know, what I think is interesting, just getting to rub shoulders with leaders like yourself and people who are influencing culture, you know, when you hear their story and you kind of pull back the curtain, you know, you all are struggling with identity issues as much as the next person. You know, people see you and the other team, rest of the team at Skywatch, like, man, they've got TV shows and they've written multiple books. And it's like they think you're just on the mountaintop and you know how to do it because they just see the final product. You know, they don't always see that, well, this actually took a year to make this or, you know, to get to this point where I'm this good at writing. It was like 7 years of work and struggling through several initial projects to be like, okay, now I actually kind of know what I'm doing and can do some really good things. So I like that you are open about that because that often gives other people permission to be like, oh, I don't have it all figured out yet either, but gosh, I feel like God's calling me. I feel inspired to go after this important thing. Well, I could work hard and do that just like Josh did or Derek and Sharon did or whoever it is. So appreciate that. Thanks for just being upfront and humble about it because that always gives other people the permission to go out and do the same thing and accomplish big dreams as well. I'm curious to hear how you approach finding sources for the film. Like I, while you were talking, as I was thinking about what I want to ask you next, I have a good friend who his name is David Amerlin. He has a book called The Sniper's Mind. And initially he's like, how do I find like people in like snipers, former special forces people to be sources for my book? And he like started putting ads out on Craigslist and somebody's like, it's like, dude, this is a way to get on a watch list, not find sources for a book. And I was like, okay. David learned quickly that was not the best route. So I'm curious, how do you safely go about finding sources to do a whole documentary film about the dark side of sex trafficking and child trafficking? So how did you approach that? That had to be kind of a tenuous thing to figure out.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, especially thinking, you know, if I Google search like child sex trafficking, am I going to be on some NSA list or something? You know,
Josh, I think you already might be on some NSA list. I don't know. So be careful,
yeah,
my friend.
Kidding. Yeah. So like that was a challenge. That was a unique challenge because I know how, and my only experience again is from writing, and I know how I do it in a book. Like if I need an expert, like if I need an interview for a book, and I've done that before, where I'll put interviews in books, then I, whatever the topic is, I will go and try to watch any kind of media I can find, usually on YouTube or something, because that's where you find interviews typically, sometimes in articles too, but usually for me, it's hard for me to sit and read an interview. I want to see the person. I want to kind of get a sense of who they are. You know, you can't really get that in the written word. I want to know if they're somebody that I can work with, you know, because if they're just arrogant, then they could be the smartest person in the world. But if they just have a bad attitude, I don't have any interest in it. So I kind of approached it like that. I watched every documentary I could find on child sex trafficking, every single one from like big budget stuff to little independent stuff. And I actually lucked out a little bit because there's not a whole lot of them. And, you know, that's probably not a great thing. There should be more. So from what I saw, I made lists of every movie, and maybe I should publish those sometime on my website, like movie reviews, but I made lists of like pros and cons, you know, things that I really liked, things that you know, I thought might work well in my movie, and then things that I just didn't like or things that I thought could be done better or differently, or maybe that's just my style is a little different than that too. And what I really looked at was who they chose to be in the film. Did they choose experts based on their expertise or based on name recognition? And unfortunately, with this topic, there were some films where it was more about name recognition than expertise. And I didn't want to do that. Now, to a certain extent, it's you're putting somebody on camera. You need somebody that can speak and, you know, that's not going to get really nervous, and because that can be an issue too. So I did want to find people that had some kind of media experience, but that made it easy with just looking up interviews on YouTube and just seeing, you know, who speaks most authoritatively about this, who speaks about this in the way that I'm looking for. You know, they don't sensationalize it, but they don't sugarcoat it either. And I originally found 12. That was my original list. We whittled it down to 7 because COVID travel restrictions made it kind of impossible to bring some of the people on that I wanted to bring on. But it actually turned out to be a God thing, because we got so much just gold from these 7 experts that if we had 12, it wouldn't have made it in the movie. It would be a totally different movie. And I don't think it would have been as impactful, because it would have been just too many people. And that was actually in my cons list. Some of the movies that I watched, they would have like 20, 30 experts. To me, it's like too many. With this topic, you know, you want to evoke some emotion from people, which means you have to have a human connection for them to really understand what's going on. And when you have 20, 30 experts rattling off statistics the whole movie, while it's very important information and we need that, you don't get as much of the human connection. And to me, that said, you know, if that human connection isn't there, I don't think the motivation to do anything is there too. So what's my goal? Is my goal to make and sell a factual movie, or is my goal to inspire viewers to do something about this problem? And I definitely wanted to inspire people to do something. If 10 people watch the movie and actually do something, to me, that's better than 1,000 people watching it and don't do anything. So that was kind of my motivation for that. So, the top expert I could find, the most engaging, who's not afraid to put his credibility on the line and just tell people what's going on, is Jakob Bunyans. And so he's in the film. He is fantastic, just an excellent all around person, let alone speaker. But he's been in this fight for most of his life now. He actually helped rescue his sister from sex trafficking in South Africa, and his sister, Alonka Deaton, she's in the movie as well. So the beginning of the movie, the first part of the movie, kind of goes back and forth between Alonka's story and the factual statistical stuff that Jakob brings to the table. But he also brings like personal experiences, things that he's seen working in the field. So that's kind of how it starts out. It kind of plays back and forth between, you know, Alonka's really heart-wrenching story, but which does have, you know, a happy ending, at least as happy as a story like that can have. It goes between her and then Jakob and all this statistical stuff. So I wanted to find people like that. I can tell you who's in the movie too. There's only 7 people in it, but I'm in it, but not in it, because I'm not an expert. I know about it now from doing all the research for this movie, but I'm more of like the person that just guides people along through the movie. So I'm not in it very much. But Jakob Bunyans, he's like the main guy. He's in every part of the movie. He's really what the movie kind of surrounds around. Alonka Deaton, David Heavener is in it. He's like a Hollywood insider producer. He's seen a lot of just horrific things just in his time in Hollywood. And I wanted to deal with that topic too, because a lot of times that the Hollywood elite kind of stuff gets sensationalized, and it's hard to find the truth. You know, what's really going on here, and it becomes a topic where it's too easy for people to say, well, that's all conspiracy. There's actual truth there, but you have to kind of sort through all of the sensationalism to get there, because there's a lot of sensationalist stuff too online. So I wanted to bring David in because I know him personally, and I've always found him to be a reliable source of information. And if he doesn't know something, he'll say he doesn't know something. So for example, you remember that story a couple of years ago about that oil oil bleeding bio thing, you know?
Yep.
He did a video on that got like a couple of million views. But in the in his video about it, he didn't take like necessarily a hard stance one way or another about it. He asked questions. And then later he did an episode. He's got a show. He did an episode on it where he interviewed people from both sides of that argument. You know, so people who definitely felt that that was a fake thing. It was a fraud. It's not a real miracle. And then people who believe that it was a real miracle. And at the end of the episode, he doesn't tell you what he thinks. He leaves it up to the audience. So I really liked that he's willing to ask questions. He's willing to go where people might be uncomfortable going, but he doesn't feel like he has to take a hard stance on anything. So to me, that showed honesty and integrity. That if he doesn't know something, he will tell me he doesn't know, and he's not gonna, you know, make something up just to put something interesting in a movie. So I wanted him in there. Stephen Bancars, he's a co-author of mine. We wrote about coming out of New Age theology into Christianity. We wrote a book called Second Coming of the New Age. He's got, you know, he came out of New Age theology, Satanism, you know, this kind of stuff. And some of that kind of dovetails with the occult side of child sex trafficking. So he's in it. Thomas Dunn, he's a filmmaker, director of a movie called Detestable. He's an advocate for victims of satanic ritual abuse, and he works with other experts to assist people coming out of SRA, helping them to adjust to a normal life. And the whole SRA thing, I wanted it in the movie because I believe that there is something about it that's true, but I wanted to be really careful because that is something that does get sensationalized. And so I didn't want to bring anybody into the movie that I thought there was going to be any chance that it was going to get sensationalized, because I want to get the truth about, you know, kids that are being abused and how they're abused. I want to get that out, and I don't want to sensationalize it. I think that does a disservice to children who have been through this. So I found Thomas Dunn. I've known him for a few years, and I found him to be a reliable source for that type of thing. Russ Dizdar is another one that we tried to get in the movie, but we couldn't because of travel restrictions. We were able to get an audio interview with him, though, and that's included with the movie if people get it at skywatchtvstore.com. That interview is included. But then we also have Joe Horn and Tom Horn, and they both help run Whispering Ponies Ranch, which is a place of healing for children who have been rescued from child sex trafficking. So they have a lot of expertise in this, and they live it out every day through this ministry. By the way, I should mention, too, all the profits of Silent Cry, so people get the movie, whether on Amazon or DVD or wherever they get the movie, all the profits go to Whispering Ponies Ranch. So it really does help. And then it's narrated by John B. Wells, who's got one of the most recognizable voices, I think, ever, you know, in the history of mankind. He narrated it. And I wrote the introduction and the conclusion to the film, and he was kind enough to donate his time and resources. He narrated the movie. Derek Gilbert also narrates the very first part of the movie, which is about the Finders cult. So I wrote that. He narrated that, and that is, yeah, that's everybody. It's a small group compared to a lot of other movies out there. But I think the information that these experts bring out far make up for, you know, the kind of smaller number. And for me, I actually like that there's fewer people in it, because you really get to know the people through the film. Like, you get to know them as people. And I think that that's more impactful. So that's kind of what I went for there.
Well, I like too, just the, you brought in some outside experts, but a lot of the people you worked with are people who are personal friends of yours, people that you do life and ministry with. So just the quality of the collaboration is so much higher, because you're in relationship with these people. You know them, they know you, your style, how you might want to tell a story. So I would imagine just your ability to do a higher quality work, I would imagine that came through a lot faster.
Yeah, it definitely helped because, some of these people were brand new. I didn't know Yako or Alanka before this. But some of them, like David or Steve or Tom, both Toms, you know, Joe, I've known them for years, and I've seen the work that they do in this field. And when I think expert on child sex trafficking, I think of those people. And so, yeah, having that relationship already built, like, really helped out a lot. And I think I'm biased, but, you know, I think a better movie came through it, like you said.
And, you know, Josh, this has been out for a little while now. And in terms of reactions of the people who have seen the film, like, what surprises them most? What's that thing where they're like, Josh, I had no idea, or Josh, this is just unbelievable. What's the thing that really provokes them, bothers them, stirs them up?
how common it is. That's absolutely top of the list. It's not even, I mean, the SRA stuff is horrifying, you know, the occult connections. And that's why the subtitle is called, you know, the darker side of trafficking. You know, people are asking me, well, does that mean there's a lighter side? And it's like, no, it means that there's a darker side that people don't know about because it's not talked about in mainstream media. Nobody talks about the occult side of this whole thing. And there is an occult side. Now, the numbers of, you know, the occult connections are far less than the trafficking itself, but there is a connection there. And we deal with that in the film. So that's what the subtitle is all about. But what surprises people the most and surprised me the most, too, was how common this is in America. And nobody wants to admit it nobody wants to think of our country is that, you know, we like to think of America as like the shining beacon of the world. And in many ways it is. In many ways, it is that. So when we hear that this kind of thing is happening below the surface and how frequent it happens, how it's in, I don't want to say it's in every single small town in America, because I obviously have not checked every single small town, but it seems like it's in every small town in America. I mean, it's horrific. 500,000, the most conservative numbers that I could find that are accurate. I mean, there's numbers all over the place that are just speculative, but the most conservative numbers I could find that are accurate are about 500,000 kids are being trafficked per day. Every single day, 500,000 kids in America. Now, that's a low number. It could be, you know, 5 years ago, I heard another person who we had out at Skywatch TV, Opal Singleton. She said that it was that at that time, 5 years ago, it was 1 million kids. That's what her ministry, those were the numbers that her ministry pulled up. And so it very well could be. And by now it could be even more than that, but it's at least 500,000. That's horrific. One out of four victims of trafficking are children. It's that high of a percentage. You know, usually we think of, okay, well, there's human trafficking, and then there's this kind of offshoot child sex trafficking, which happens every now and then, but it's not that common. It's 25% and rising. But I mean, even the average age of kids, the average life expectancy of children in sex trafficking today is just 7 years old. That's their life expectancy. That's how long they're predicted to live if they're in child sex trafficking, only 7 years. So numbers like that is what really gets to people. And we really wanted to highlight that and put that in like the very first part of the movie. The very first thing we deal with in the movie is the whole Finders case, because I wanted to show people, look, we can't trust the government to just solve this problem for us. You know, it's a solution to this problem is not going to come in the form of we elect the right person in and then we get the right law passed and then it's done away with. That can help. But, you know, and certainly our current president is doing some good things, but that is not going to be the ultimate solution to this problem. What it's going to be is individuals deciding that they're going to take it upon themselves to be a part of the solution. Because we find ourselves in a situation in America where people are either part of the problem or part of the solution. There is no in between. There is no fence to be on. And the reason is because the traffickers want people to be inactive. And if we're speaking spiritually, Satan wants people to be inactive. If a person is inactive in this fight, then they're allowing it. They're complicit. They're allowing it to happen. But even more than that, you know, 68% of Christian men are addicted to pornography. This isn't just people who are viewing porn one time. I mean, this is an actual active addiction, 68%. There is a direct one-to-one link, undeniable. People can just Google this and find numerous articles about it from reputable sources. There is a direct one-to-one link between pornography, just what we might call normal adult pornography, and child sex trafficking. You can't be a part of one without being a part of another. If you view porn, you are actively supporting child sex trafficking. There's just no way around it, no way to deny it. And 68% of Christians are addicted to porn. Now, granted, they don't know about the link, but if they're watching this now you do know. And I'm totally comfortable taking people's ignorance away from them and telling them, you know, you can't deny this anymore. So there are things that people can do, like in their own lives, have a stronger relationship with your wife and your kids. You know, if you've got family problems, you got to get that fixed. And the only real way to do that is with Christ at the center of your household. But, you know, traffickers thrive and thrive on the dysfunctionality of families today. So if a daughter doesn't have a great relationship with her father, for example, that is like that. That's a trafficker's dream. That's the situation that they look for because they can fulfill that role. They can get the girl to do whatever they want. A lot of kids who are trafficked, they live at home and the parents don't know that they're trafficked because it's not always a kidnapping situation. Sometimes that happens, but more often the kid is at home. It's usually a girl, but the numbers for boys are steadily rising too. It'll be a preteen or a teenager at home, and the parents just notice there's this attitude change. They don't know what it is, but they just assume that, well, that's what happens when you become a teenager. But unfortunately, what happens is that that child is being trafficked, and they're either being threatened or they're being coerced into not telling their parents. They're allowed to go home when it's done. And they're either threatened and told, if you tell your parents, we're going to kill your family. That happened to Ilanka in the movie. Or the girl doesn't have a strong relationship with her dad, or there's something broken at home. So the girl finds what she thinks is love in this older guy. And she's convinced that this trafficking thing, you know, the guy will tell her, look, you can't tell anybody this because they're not going to understand. They don't understand how in love we are. You know, and that really speaks to a young girl who has even a slightly broken home and not a strong relationship with her dad. So traffickers thrive on that. There's a lot of things that people can do at home within their own families. Even sexually explicit movies have no place in the home. You know, things like that. We can get this turned around, but it's not going to be done through the government. The government's just far too corrupt. And if we want this done, it's going to take each individual person taking this seriously, deciding to get the correct information. And I really wanted to make Silent Cry to be like the first place people can go to get the right information in a way that's not going to, you know, horrify. I mean, it's not like a slasher movie, but that also doesn't sugarcoat anything. So, I would suggest get the movie if you can, you know, get the movie. And if people can't afford to get the movie but still want the information, watch the Sean Tabbitt Show, you know, watch Skywatch TV. We do everything we can to put information out there for free for people because, again, it's not about making money. All the profits go to Whispering Ponies Ranch, so it is to support that ministry. But what we're more concerned with is getting the word out there to people. So get the movie if you can. Leave it a good review because good reviews help convince Amazon to suggest it to their other viewers. We can make this go global, but it's going to take each of us working together. So those are some practical steps that people can take.
Well, and one of the things I appreciate about the film is it's not over the top gratuitous. You do explore and talk about difficult things there between some of the cases you cover, some of the stories that are shared. They're difficult to listen to because they're awful. Yet at the same time, you're like, okay, we're going to gaze into this Pandora's box. But here's the realities. And, I think people are going to be surprised at how rampant trafficking is here in the States. I think a lot of times people think, well, this is something that happens in third world countries or other parts of the world, but certainly not in my town or not in my small town. And I appreciate what you said earlier in terms of that one-to-one correlation or connection between pornography and sex trafficking, that if people are consuming pornography, you're directly feeding the sex trafficking industry. So, for better or worse, we are in a global culture and the internet connects all of us all over the world and people will do a lot of crazy things to make money. And trafficking is one thing that makes people a lot of money. So I love that you're inviting people to gaze into the Pandora's box, bringing them to a place where once they're aware of this information and they've seen some of what you share, they can't unsee it. And so, my hope, my prayer is that they're going to be provoked in their heart that they need to do something that God's going to be like, here's how you can pour into this cause. I think the simplest thing, like Josh said, leave a review, tell other people about the movie. For people who, were just going to have any level of interest, this is an important topic to explore. So this is an easy way to at least get the ball rolling. Josh, anything, you've said a lot, but I always like to give my guests a chance. Anything we didn't cover that you want to make sure we work in before we wrap up the interview?
I think that that pretty much covers it for this interview. But yeah, I would just really emphasize the fact that if we're going to see any kind of change in this area, it's going to take individuals. It's not going to be waiting around for the government. And if you've watched this interview, I'm totally comfortable in saying this. I have now taken your ignorance away from you. You don't get to sit on the fence anymore. You're either part of the problem or part of the solution. And the good thing about it is it does not take much to be part of the solution. Get your family in order, live a godly life, you know, make Christ the center of your world and everything you do, cultivate a good relationship with your kid, you know, all of those kinds of things. That kind of thing can spread out to the community. Community can spread out to, you know, the larger cities, and that can spread out statewide across the country and across the world. It's going to take individuals stepping up and deciding, you know what, we're not going to support anything financially that is sexually explicit. I loved seeing the whole cancel Netflix thing over that movie, Cuties. I thought that was great. You know, finally, people are voting with their dollar. You know, we're not going to support that. And that I don't think people realize, too, how far their dollar goes, you know, how much that convinces people, how much that feeds a culture. We have an over-sexualized culture because people are buying this stuff. People are watching these movies. If we just stop looking at it, it goes away. I mean, it's almost like magic. If you stop looking at it, it goes away. But it's not going to come in the form of just some new law that can help support it, but it's gonna have to be a cultural movement, individuals deciding that they're gonna be part of the solution, not part of the problem. So again, if people want to get the movie, skywatchtvstore.com, they can pick it up there with a whole bunch of extra bonus materials. It's only a $35 donation, and you get the movie and a whole bunch of stuff. It's something like I think it's almost like a $200 value or something like that, so it's a really good deal. Or you can stream it on Amazon, and either way, go to IMDb or go to Amazon, look up the movie, and leave a review if you've watched it, because those good reviews. Right now we have about 16 five-star reviews, and that's a great start, but we're going to need a lot more to convince Amazon that this is the kind of content they should be showing on their streaming service. So we can take this culture back. We can turn it around, but it's going to take all of us working together. So thank you so much, Sean. This has been great talking with you again. I really appreciate you taking the time to have me on.
Well, Josh, definitely my pleasure. And like we do with every episode, we'll have detailed links in the show notes, places where you can connect with Josh and pick up a physical copy or stream a copy of the film. It's time to bring this episode of the Sean Tabbitt Show to a close. Many thanks for being a part of my conversation with Josh Peck. Once again, our film today was Silent Cry, The Darker Side of Trafficking. For more on the film, head on over to skywatchtvstore.com. And Josh, once again, thank you so much for sharing with us today. It's been an honor. It's been a pleasure to have you on the show.
My pleasure. Thank you.